Now, I'm also going to read out of Mark, too. We'll start with Matthew. Matthew 18, verse 21. Then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how oft shall my brother sin against me? And I forgive him till 7 times. Jesus saith unto him, I say not unto thee until 7 times, but until 70 times 7. Let me read that again. Then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how oft shall my brother sin against me? And I forgive him till 7 times. Jesus saith unto him, I say not unto thee until 7 times, but until 70 times 7. Now turn over to Mark, the 11th chapter. Mark 11 and verse 25. Mark 11 and starting with verse 25. And when ye stand praying, forgive if ye have aught against any, that your Father also, which is in heaven, may forgive you your trespasses. But if ye do not forgive, then neither will your Father, which is in heaven, forgive your trespasses. If ye do not forgive, neither will your Father, which is in heaven, forgive your trespasses. Can we pray? Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we come to you, Lord, asking, oh Lord, that you would begin to open up ears and open up hearts to listen and to receive this message, your word. God, I'm asking that you would touch me, God, as I would present this word to you, Lord. Anoint me, help me, oh Lord, let the Holy Ghost flow in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, if you ain't figured out what this is about, forgiveness. Just one word. You know, when we started school, and you either started Head Start or you start kindergarten, they teach a whole lot of different things. They teach you how to use the magic word, which is please and thank you. Probably y'all learned that off of Barney, too. He loved Barney so much, I hate that blessed dinosaur. He watched it on TV. Then I had to buy on how many tapes of Barney, Barney, Barney. That's all they want. Please and thank you. Please and thank you. That's the magic words. But the teacher also taught us a very important lesson. And it's this. To share. Now sometimes you got them bad kids in that classroom that'll sit there and snatch and take the toy away from your kid, or take the toy away from one of the kids, or one of the kids who would push you down, or one of the little kids that would punch you, and so on and so on. Well, when the teacher saw this happen, she came, got both kids together. And what did she make you do? Apologize. And say, I'm sorry. Say, I forgive you. You don't do that. I'm sorry. Then you're sorry. But it's a funny thing about kids. Kids can be playing 1 minute, then they'll be arguing the next. But when they're arguing and fussing and fighting, then they say, you know, they're going back to playing with each other. So they forgive it. They don't worry about it. As long as it just involves kids, it's fine. But when the parents start sticking their nose in it, well, all kind of trouble break loose. The parents start fighting. Somebody calls a police officer. Somebody ends up going to jail. Well, if you just kept your nose out of it, the kids would have been okay. It's just like the baseball field. They've got 20 times worse from what I could hear is when Poncho and Hunter used to play. Oh, my God. Every year the cops just call their fuss and carrying on and won't let the kid talk to that kid. And it's crazy. It's craziness. There are two words in the English language that people hate to use. It seems like it's the hardest for them to say. I'm sorry. Say anything thing is like, honey, if you had tell them to tell somebody sorry, they'd rather die or they'd rather get beat than have to go apologize to somebody. This is the reason why a lot of marriages get in trouble. This is the reason why a lot of marriages end up in divorce. Because they don't want to use that word. That's the reason why a lot of families have been split up. Because you hold a grudge, you don't want to say I'm sorry. You don't want to admit fault. Sons, oh, I didn't do it. You ain't got some people, honey, I know they're folks right now, but they'll never admit they're wrong. They always right, no matter what you say, no matter if they started a fight, no matter if they started an enemy, they know they were in the wrong, but they ain't about to tell you that they're sorry. I'm sorry. Well, newsflash, you cannot be right all the time. If you were right all the time, then it wouldn't be no fuss. It wouldn't be no problem. It wouldn't be no argument. If everybody was right all the time, somebody did something. And oftentimes, sometimes, you have to apologize whether you did anything or not. Be the bigger person. Be the grown up as they say it's going on. Well, like, you know, I'm sorry. And you didn't do nothing wrong. Whether you get a sorry or not back, most of you do that, they ain't going to give it back to you. You got folks out on the street that will walk the other way and keep speaking to you. If you've had disagreement with them, or they mad at you for whatever, you just look like you do. Some people, it don't matter. You can be nice to them, and they still hate you. You ain't ever did nothing but good to them, and they still hate you for some reason. Just because you're you, I guess. I don't know. But whatever the problem is, they will see you out because of disagreement now. That happened 20 years ago, like we were talking about with the Hatfields and McCoys, 20 years ago. I don't speak to him. You speak to your brother? No. You speak to him? No. Why not? Well, because I'm supposed to get mom's pictures than they got. And you want to see a fight, you let it be a death in the family. Or especially to mommy and daddy. Over stuff. Over stupid stuff. Jay's crazy family, they mom not got, they didn't want the baby boy to be staying in the house, Jimbo to live in the house. So me and Spice them decide they just go in there and just wreck the house. Well then if he get to stay there, then we gonna tell, they stole everything out of the house. Even the toilet tissue. They stole the food out the deep freezer, even the toilet tissue. I mean, come on people, that's just ignorant. Home grudge is over stupid. But I mean, it's a lot of families that's like that now.
Yep.
They get mad over something that sometimes it ain't even worth, I mean, some silly stuff, it ain't even worth about arguing about.
Right.
But oh God, don't you let, I wish you know how your kids are. When I bought with them something, okay, I learned it. Bought punch on 100, same thing. I'm avoiding this fight. Then I turn around, then they get mad because, well, his is blue and mine's red. But I'm going to fix y'all there about both of them. The same toy, the same color. They don't say nothing else to me about it. But you'd be surprised at people. And the bad part about it is a lot of us Christians. You got a lot of Christians that won't speak to each other. They'll be in church shouting shoe heels off. Run all over church, shout, speak to Toma, and there they are sitting by that sister. Just say, sister Sue here, and you over there, and you're mad, and ain't speaking. But you shout all over. There's a problem with that. There's a problem with that. That you don't have an ought against your brother. The word says, you're not supposed to walk around with hate in your heart. And the Bible teaches us in Matthew, I'm reading it at that same chapter, in verse 15 through 18. Moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. Thee and him alone. Not W-Y-N-T. Not everybody in the church. Not everybody in Harlem. He said between you two alone, by yourself. Then the word says, and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. If he shall hear thee, thou hast gained thy brother. But if he will not hear thee, then take with thee one or two more witnesses. That in the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word must be established. So the Bible's telling you, if y'all got a problem with each other, go talk it out. Number two, now, he still don't want to talk to you, then you go get somebody to go with him. So you can say, okay, now you're a witness. I'm trying to make this right. That's step number two. And then it says, if he shall neglect to hear them, tell it unto the church. But if he neglect to hear the church, let him be unto thee as a heathen man and a publican. So you go between you two first. Then if he don't think that ain't happening, go get somebody else a witness. If they ain't happening, look, this needs to go before the church. Boy, I tell you what, how many churches actually do that?
Not many.
I don't say the magic word. Not many. Because if they did, you would avoid a lot of problems. You would avoid a lot of division in church. You would dissolve all kind of fightings and arguments, everything going on in the church. You would keep the church from getting split if we would do everything like the Bible says. But now we don't do nothing like the Bible, so we do it our own way. Like some, no, if somebody's got a problem with somebody, I don't know, I'm not going to go talk to you. And then turn around and go talk to you. No. We on the Bible says, come and let us reason together. Me and you and whoever else is going to sit down at the same time and talk and find out now. Get it all out. Now when this is done, it's over with. Because we are sisters or brothers or however you're going to be in the church. That's where it's supposed to be. It ain't nothing but the devil. They showed this cartoon one time about how, and it was like kiddie, but it was the truth. They were showing how little kids was playing, and here comes the devil on his shoulder. Look at how they're making fun of what you got on. They're looking at you, they making fun of you, they laughing at you, that's what they're laughing about. Then you got angels on this, no, what are you talking about? But see, that devil is in there saying, look at him. They making fun of you. And you know the person might not even be looking at you. Or laughing at you. Oh, but see, that's the devil's job. To keep up division and torment. A house divided can't stand. That's what the Bible says. But the devil's doing that. Why? Because he wants you to get mad at them. And instead of us thinking, well, no, recognizing who it is, which the devil is causing the problem. I ain't going to be mad at my brothers, this and that and the other. The devil's going to do that, you know why? Because he's going to make you mad. They ain't going to push y'all trying to fight. Or you going to leave the church and take 20 folks with you and all that. Well, if you just, I ain't trying to hear that devil. Well, if they all look at me, laugh at me, well then, you know, God bless them. I had to forgive them. They making fun of me. But 9 times out of 10, it ain't what you think it is. The situation is not always as it appears to be. You know, on your car with the roof or the side mirror that says objects may be closer than what they appear to be. Well, that's it right there. The situation is not as bad as you think it is. Or it's not how that person could be looking at you thinking, well, I like that outfit. I like that. And they like just Lord trying to steal all my clothes all the time. They could be looking at you and say, oh, I like how they got their hair done. But the devil's telling you, look how they're looking at you. They talking about you right now. So the person's not true. People can be doing that, but all the time, that ain't how it is. But that's what the devil wants you to think. Because he wants to put blinders on you. So then, when you do apologize to that person, and they don't accept it, guess what? It's all for you. You done your part. Now, if they don't want to accept it, that's fine. You know that you're not even supposed to go to bed, man. Because one of you might not wake up in the morning. Ephesians 4 and 26 said, be ye angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath. So you might say, what? It's a sin to get mad? No, that's not the sin. Because Jesus himself got mad when they was in his father's house gambling, blowing money and all that. Jesus Jesus got mad, he whipped him out the temple. Because he said, why? My father's house is a house of prayer. You've made the den of thieves. He got mad. There's a difference in getting mad and sinning not. You get mad enough to punch somebody in the face or beat them up or something just clicks or you try to kill them or blah, 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 blah. That's where sin comes. And oh boy, don't let your anger or your temper get you in trouble. How many people, some of them, majority, a lot of them, in the jails or in there today because of temper? It's kind of a temper. Prince, you there a bad temper. If you take me there, it's been a long time since I went, but I can go there. Your temper can get the best of you. And that's why you got to pray, Lord, take this away from me. Look, just fly off the handle, man. Just fly. And before you know it, something, a little bit thing, you blew a whole lot of proportion because of your temper. I should have kept my mouth shut, zipped it up. I put my big foot in my mouth. But you'd be surprised I can get you in trouble. Your way of thinking gets you in trouble. Oh, and don't let me tell you something else, something newsflash. Don't believe everything everybody says when they come tell you something. A lot of people like to just see trouble start. They're like, I tell them, here, we are a family. This is our church. It's nobody else's business what goes on in here but ours. If they want to know what's going on, let them walk through them two doors. You can see it. We can tell you the good going on, but it ain't none of your business. You don't want to know, but some people just do that. They hate to see you doing good. They hate to see you doing good things. They hate to see you be a good person. They hate to see you because you're a changed person. So the devil is going to send them just for something that I don't care. Something that can get your goat 10 years ago and have get you riled up again. But all these years, you get riled up again. Why? Because that's what the devil wants to do. And people don't like to see people be at peace. Well, that's the truth right there. That's the devil. Anytime there's confusion, he's not the author of it. People, you don't like to pray and see, that's not God. You know that ain't God, because God's not the author of confusion. But we can get in trouble. Oh, man, can we? Good Lord have mercy. When two men went to Hiram, I believe it was Hiram. Bill Cone's church. I can't remember if it was there, if it was at Trinity one. But Keith Creech was preaching. And he looked at this one man and he told him, he said, you need to get your house in order. If you got any problems with anybody, you need to be making it right. Because by this time next year, you'll be gone. The man there, now both of them are preachers now. Preach, well, preachers don't do that good. Yeah, they're the world's worst for it. Get mad at this one because y'all got more people than they do. What difference does it make people, all the people getting saved? It shouldn't make a difference. You should be working together, not apart anyway. You'd be surprised. Preachers are the worst ones. And so he did that to his preachers. So when the preacher, there was preaching, told him that. Him and this other preacher don't even know what the argument or whatever the difference was about. So he, the one that he told wasn't going to see next year, or this time next year, he went up to apologize to the other one. He got his apology out. Other preacher said, well, you can go ahead and don't die. Hold your breath or whatever. I won't apologize to you. Never will. Well, come May of the following year, the one man that apologized, he was gone. The Lord took him. Who you think gonna get forgiven? The one that God took, because he went and tried to get it right. It was the other one that didn't want to. Now the other one's one gonna be in trouble, because he wouldn't accept that. He didn't even apologize to him, so he's gonna have to answer that when he gets in front of God. You see what I'm saying? How you let it get the best of you? I'm right. I know I'm right. Pride comes before destruction. Hawk the spirit before fall. Your pride will get you in trouble sometime. And so Jesus says here, in Matthew with 21:22, when Peter said, "Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? 7 times? And Jesus said unto him, "No, I say not unto thee until 7 times, but until 70 times 7. You know how many times that is? 490 times you gotta forgive somebody. And somebody laughed one time and said, "Well, what about the 491? Do I have to ask forgiveness then?" Yeah, you do. What if it's 400? It said 490. What about 491? But Matthew 5:44 says, "But I say it to you, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. And pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you." So in other words, Jesus saying, well, it's easy to love somebody loves you. That's easy. It's easy to love somebody that's doing good to you. You're doing good to them, man. That's easy. It's easy when people being good to you. It's easy to be good to them kind of people. But oh, what about when the people lying on you? Oh, what about when they're talking about you? Oh, what about when they putting you down? Oh, and betraying you and saying all this stuff, making fun of you and hurting you. It ain't so easy then, is it? But we have to do it. If we got Jesus on the inside of us, it spills out on the outside. I just saw when I see some on the inside working on the outside. Oh, what a change in my life. So when you see people that say they're Christians and they still act the same that they did supposed to when they got saved, honey, something wrong. Because when you got Jesus in here, he's going to spit out. It's going to come out. Because God is love. You can't be saved. Don't give me, "Yeah, man, people make you mad. Oh boy, God, I gotta have time to forgive this," because I'm like, whoa. But if you won't go to heaven, you gotta forgive them. And he said that it makes your enemies, and I know it does, because I'm a witness. Do you know that it makes your enemies even that much madder when you good to them? Oh, they expect you to cuss them out and hit them and all this kind of stuff. But Lord, when you good to them, oh, you're talking about getting mad. Oh, like their father. Oh, he want to talk nasty to me and all that. And I said, well, what do you mean, honey? I just walked on off and let him stand there. Look like boo boo the fool. I just walked on there and talk about, well, it takes two people to argue. If you walk up, okay, yeah, see you later, love you, bye, thank you. That makes, I know that made him that much more mad if I'd have stood there and argued with him. Why? That makes him more, gosh, yeah, than it would be used. That's what they want to do. That's what the devil wants you to do, is stand and argue. That's what the devil wants you to do, is stand there and fight. That's what he wants you to do. When you get to the place that you can walk off from somebody like that, you know you're getting close to God. Because the old you might punch that person. That old you might kick that person. That old you might have cussed somebody out.
Ain't that right there saying
that? That old you might have cussed them out. That old you might have done something trying to get back at him. Something evil to get back at him. That's how you know, honey, when you get close to the Lord and you arrive, because you ain't let that old man come up and be like it used to be. Let God fight your battles, because he knows how to do it. He knows what to do. He knows when to do it. He don't need no help. That's why in Romans 12:19 it says, "Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord." It also says in Romans 12:20, "Therefore, If thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. And I got another one for you. Proverbs 16:7. When a man's ways please the Lord, he maketh even his enemies to be at peace with him. When you please the Lord, they don't know. Well, I don't know why what's changed about them. There's a story Brother Doyle told. They was two brothers. One of the guys saved, was still a sinner. I can't remember now what he did. He did when he'd been drinking or something. But they was at his mama's house. And his brother walks up to him and says, if you don't do something, he said, I'm going to punch you right in the face. And he said, well. So he drew his fist and bam, knocked him right off the porch. The brother just got right up and dusted himself off. Well, what you going to do? You going to hit me? Hit me. He said, no, I'm not. Well, I hit you again then. He said, well, I guess that's what you have to do, brother. So he went off and not hit him again. He knocked him off the boy's mama's porch again. You know, he's thinking, well, what's wrong? Any other time, we'd be out there fighting. They'd be trying to pull us apart. He hit him the same time. He said, I'm not going to hit you. You told me I'm saved. I'm not going to. And so he kept on. So said the other brother jumped in the car. He took off down the road somewhere. So he went in there at mama's house and he got a washcloth and stuff and he was wiping himself off, wiping the blood off and all that on his face. Here come his brother. Uh-oh. He said, well, here we go again. Round number two. You getting cold. We'll turn the air down. You call it rain. Okay? And I said, I can't finish. See, I was crying just long enough to say, how cold? So here comes the brother back again. He said, oh Lord, I cleaned myself up too soon, I guess. When the brother had done the hitting, got out the car. And as he began to walk up on the porch, he started crying. And he come and he hugged the other brother and he said, what's the matter with you? He said, something's different about you. Something done changed about you. And he told me he got saved. And so the brother, the done the hitting, turned around as he was crying and said, well, pray for me, I want to get saved too. And he was changed too. See, that just goes to show, if he had got on in the fight with the brother, his brother never got saved that day. But because he showed him different, because he showed him the love of God, he knew, so that's what I'm saying. Honey, when you change, people should be able to see it. They'll see it. Give you away. There's something about you. You used to do so and so. Well, you don't want that. You don't want to go here. You don't want. No. People will see a change in you. You're supposed to let your light shine. That's a change. So when you are with the Lord, he'll even make your enemies at peace with you. Well, you talking about we should feed? I go, yeah. I'll feed somebody, my enemy, all right. I'll put some poison in there on them. I'll put some something in there. Hey, tell you what my mama did to me. What my mama did to my brother, Uncle Joe Bob, he always picked mama. And mama fixed him, I'm gonna fix you. And mama went and got some X-lay. And you know how X-lays has got to sit in the bloom to follow like several four. And mom took it, she took the candy and chocolate out, she wrapped the X-lays up in it, and she goes, hey, Joe Bob, you want some candy? And he said, yeah, I know that's how he snatched it out of my head. But I said, yeah, eat all you want. I got another extra bar over here. Oh. And Uncle Joe Bob made that whole thing extra. Oh. And he was in the bathroom. And Mom said, well, Mama found out what I did to the old boy. She said, I got a bad whooping, but Mom said it was worth it. It was worth it. So when they see people, don't. And any other time, if you said something to me, you'd have been knocked out. But because of who is on the inside, working on the outside, places you used to go, you don't go there no more. People used to hang with you, don't hang with them no more. People that used to talk. talk to, you ain't having to talk to them no more. When they really get mad, then you don't do that no more. That's peace. Why? That's called the love of Christ. The love of Christ will change you. God is love. You can't say you're a Christian and hate everybody because God is love. You would be going against the Bible. You would be contradicting God's word if everybody come in contact with you saying you hate them. Not be a Christian, you can't. You might have some issues about getting mad, and I'm not even going to say the devil ain't going to try you. I'm not going to say they ain't going to ever going to tempt me to get mad. But the thing about it is, though, you are in control of how much it's going to let you push to do. Some people love to push your buttons, and they know how to push them. Especially kids, they know how to push them. They know how to push them. And so I guess punch and say, yeah, your parents too. He just ain't going to admit it. He'll talk to you at the church about it. He'll tell you at the church. But why? They know how to push them buttons, man. And but when you see that, well, I guess they have changed that. And when the devil sees he can't do nothing to you, get a rise out of you, then he'll just go on by this merry way till the next time. We have to forgive. It's not an option. It's a requirement. Because forgiveness is not for the other person. Guess who it's for? You. When you walk around mad all the time and you harbor hatred and unforgiveness, it eats at you like cancer. Starts off little, and before you know it, you're like a ticking time, like a stick of dynamite. I'm going to kill them. It went from like, okay, they're going to say something smart to me. It's going to go from that until I'm ready to go beat them up. It's going to go from that till I got a knife, I'm going to stab them. It's going to go from that till I got a gun, I'm going to shoot them and kill them. It's going to go from one little small tiny thing to a big thing. Set a house on fire. I'm going to kill him and his family and all of them like the mob do. You know, it just goes from one little thing unto the other. And when you don't have forgiveness, it's like a weight that weighs you down. You feel like it's a 100-pound weight on your shoulders. You try to walk around, you can't walk around. Why? Because it just keeps pushing you down, pushing you down, pushing you down. It ain't for the other person. It's for you. If you carry all that, if you harbor all that unforgiveness and that resentment, it will eat at you alive. You can see it. You can look in the mirror and see it. You'd be the most miserable person it is. Why? Because you just won't forgive somebody. You won't do it. Then let it go. It spilled out from the inside outside. You can't hardly eat. Can't hardly sleep. You can't hardly rest. Because that's all you're doing 24-7 is thinking about that. How am I going to get back at it? What can I do? You're playing it all in your mind. You think these people on these movies or these real-life serial killers and stuff, do you think they just up to kill somebody? No. They sit back and thought about it. Think that boy just going when they went to these schools and killed somebody, pulled a gun out, and just went to shoot? No. They've been sitting there thinking about that thing. So then they call that what? Premeditated murder. You can't just get up something and go out and shoot somebody and act stupid. If you're kids or teenagers or whatever. But premeditated murder is when you sit back and think about it. How can I do this? How can I plan this? Where am I going to go to do this? Why am I going? If you notice these people, then you're going to shoot up. Why they got to shoot people they don't even know? I can see it if they lose their job and go to the place and kill the boss. You can see that. But you go, well, I'm going to shoot the boss and everybody else. Well, nobody else has nothing else to you. I got to kill them all. What and why? It's only one person you're supposed to have a problem with. But that's how they do. And then it gets sold to, okay, go kill the boss. But then the devil puts in your head, well, take all the rest of them out too. And then, not only is all old life lost, then the devil will turn around and tell you, oh, you going to jail, you ain't ever getting out, you getting an electric chair. Then what happened? I don't think it's only but just a couple of these serial killers that are these people that went out and killed up a bunch of people actually did not shoot themselves. Most of the time, all of them shot themselves at the end. Yeah, all the officers, well, I'm going to go and I'm going to shoot everyone out. I'm taking everybody out. Why? Then it's so the devil's done got you to destroy all these other people and yourself too. Because they don't have to worry about going to jail. But the more they got to worry about more going to the worst place in jail. That's a place called hell. Eternal torment. You can't eat. You can't sleep. It dwells on your mind day in and day out. Day in and day out. And it's like, you cannot see the person. And you see the person's story, you'll get mad all over again. I thought I knew I would get mad again, and I see them again. I'm getting stirred up again. That's why Jesus says, we got to forgive. Who do you think puts, like I said, who do you think puts all this stuff in your head? Well, we know it ain't God. The devil. It's the devil. He wants to take as many of you as he can. He can promise you the world. And then when he's got you, he'll put you on the limb and cut a limb off. Then guess what? He destroyed you. Now he got on somebody else. See who else he can get. Jesus said here, in Mark, that if you don't forgive, if you don't forgive, you can't be forgiven. When ye stand praying, forgive, if ye have aught against any, that your Father also which is in heaven may forgive you your trespasses. But if ye do not forgive, neither will your Father, which is in heaven, forgive your trespasses. So if you don't forgive, you can't be forgiven. If you don't forgive, you might have done this sin, this horrible sin, and you need to go to Jesus and ask him for forgiveness, but God won't forgive you until you forgive. God can't move for you until you forgive. Sometimes we wonder how come God's not doing this or God's not doing that. And it's simply because, well, there's something standing our way that we ain't done. You know how you got to get through something to get to something? You just can't put an empty skillet or a cake pan in the stove and expect it to come out of cake. You have to mix all the ingredients up first. And take it, put it in the pan, and then let it bake. You can't hop from one step to another. You can't have fried chicken unless you do what? Fry it? Or go buy it, one or the other? You can't have dinner if you're just sitting there with an empty plate and fork and spoon. You gotta have some kind of dinner. You gotta make it or buy it. Well, it's the same thing with this. You can't get to point A. You can't get from point A to point B if you don't do your part and get stuff out of you. So the Lord has to cleanse us and get all the wash us, sanctify us. See, a lot of people think when the preacher say sanctification, that means cigarettes, that means all that. Well, it does, but sanctification starts in here. And when it comes to being here, it's going to pull out on the outside. Then, you know, nobody will have to tell you what to wear, what to do, what not to do, what to say. You'll know. God can talk to yourself. And I know a whole lot of them that look the part. They got the long hair. They got the skirts. They got the no makeup. They got no jewelry. And they seem like they the biggest devil it is, and they supposed to be saved. Honey, that skirt that you wear don't make you saved. It's what's in here makes you saved. You walk around down, but walk around all day long to say you're saved. But if you use 50 cuss words, 50 languages, and sleep with every Tom, Nick, and Harry, and sleep with every Sue and Jenny and whatever, guess what? That ain't gonna mean nothing because you walking with a Bible up under your arm, and that's what the scripture says. You have the form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. You have the form of, oh, I serve God. Let me put this Bible under my arm so people know what I'm saying. Well, wait a minute. Your life should show people that. You don't have to write it. You don't have to go out and walk around saying, I'm saying, you don't have to do that. There's something that people should be able to see to automatically know they're Christian. There should be a light or something radiating from you to let people know that person's saved. Pants don't make it. Skirts don't make it. Long hair, short hair, fingernail polish, whatever it is, it don't, honey, that's not sanctification. Sanctification is in here. You got to get all that dirty, nasty stuff out of it. As well, when Jennifer was mopping that little bit, she had to get swift. And she said, I'm going to put this rag on the bottom of me and mop. She said, and get some of that dirt. And she said, ooh, look at this. I said, uh-huh. Well, you couldn't get to the other clean part of fool unless you got the dirt up first. Same thing with the car. You can't just expect to walk on and drive. No, the car's clean unless you either run it through the drive or the wash, car wash. You got to wash yourself to get the top dirt off. Just can't put a greasy skillet in the water, poncho. You got to wipe it out. Why? Get some of that grease off of it. The only thing you're going to get, you're going to have greasy water. And then take a bunch of plates in the sink where the grease was, poncho. I get on them all the time, I think. You got to take that top layer of it off, that inner layer off, before you can get it in and get to cleaning it. So that's the same thing with the Lord. You got to get all of this stuff out of you like a banana. You got to peel the layers down until you get to that naked layer, and the Lord can say, now, all you got to do is forgive. And then when you do that, now that's something I can work with. Then you need the banana. You can't eat the banana with the peeling on it. You can't have them, but you can't a banana. If you do, I don't want to see it. I don't want to be there. I don't think I can be able to do it. You got to peel that off before you can get to the banana. So what do you think God does with us? Got to peel all this hatred and envy and jealousy and malice and strife, and he's got to peel all that off of you to get to you. Don't nobody know you fat but you. You got to have an idea. Huh? But honey, when you want to take these shirts off and the jacket off and the bra off and you do that, Lord, I didn't know my bed was that big like it was. Why? Because I'm looking at the outside of it. Oh, now look at this. Oh, man. It's time to exercise and do something. Cut off from that plate and do something. Why? Because you got to take the outside off to get the inside right. You can say you're going to lose weight all day, but until you start doing it, say you start into exercise or start eating right or whatever else, guess what? You still don't need to eat. Doesn't make my head. You still don't need to eat. No matter if you don't make this, yeah, I sure need to lose weight. Well, yeah, just sit on the couch and keep eating the Lay's potato chips and the Hershey bars and the dead little Debbie cakes and oh boy, I sure got to lose weight, buddy. I used to sit there and ate 20 boxes of little Debbie's. Why? Because we put down, okay, I'm going to go from 20 cakes to maybe 10 cakes a day. And break on down. Before you know it, you get that motivation. So that's the same thing with the Lord. He has to break you before he can help you. You have to be broke. The Bible says to come to him with a broken and a contrite spirit. We have to come to him with a humble heart. Not come to him like, well, you owe me this, God, and you owe me that, and I shouldn't have to do that. He's not going to listen to that. And when you come and say, Lord, I need your help. I don't know which way to do. I don't know which way to go. I need you to tell me something. Then he can begin to help. And then you got to want him. If you don't want it, ain't gonna need nobody doing nothing for you. Because they're just wasting their time because you don't want it. But now when you begin to want help, look, Jesus, I need your help. I'm sorry for everything I done. Then he comes in. But in order to get whatever else, in order to get the full blessings of God, we got to forgive. Right. We have to forgive. Think about that. When you get mad, you think, I'll never forgive you. Think about that. If you don't forgive, he won't forgive you. So if God doesn't forgive you, then what does that mean? You can't get to heaven. Mm-hmm. can't get to heaven if you ain't got, if you're not forgiving.
Right.
You can be a Christian and still not make to heaven if you got unforgiveness. People don't understand that. They think they got to get out here and do all these other types of sin. Well, what do you think that is? That's sin too. That's one of the biggest ones. Unforgiveness. You ain't going to make it for that either. Oh, what will we do if the Lord told us, I'm not going to forgive you? I don't care what you do. I'm not going to. We would be in trouble. We got to the pearly gates that day, and we'd be like, oh, Lord, what am I going to do? Can't go back. Can't lie. Because why? The Bible says he knows the very intent of your heart. You can tell me you're saved. You can tell other people you're saved. You can stand up in church and say you're saved all you want to. But if it ain't in here, you ain't never tell no lie. You can try to convince the preacher, the deacons, the church, everybody else in the world that you're saying you're such a big Christian, but who knows the truth? God does. He knows what's in your heart. He knows you tell somebody you love them. He knows even if you tell somebody, well, I forgive you if you mean it or not. I've had some people say, I forget what they know, you didn't mean it. And then I'm like this, if I have to tell you to tell to forgive me, then if I beat it, don't mean nothing. And if I have to tell you to say I'm sorry, like you have to tell somebody to say I'm sorry, then it don't mean nothing. You know what I mean? To me, that's where I am. If I tell you that you need to apologize to me and you do that, it's no good because I'm telling you to do it. But when you do it, you know when people mean it and when they don't. You know what people mean when people say, I love you. You know when it's real and you know if it ain't. You know if it's real and you know if it's just words. But I'm in a crowd of people, so I say I love them to make them think the preacher ain't talking about me. Well, you can say that all you want, but God knows who he's talking about. So he's talking about you. You can put on a part all you want to. It ain't the truth. We got to forgive. Or else we're not going to be forgiven. So tonight, if we have any unforgiveness, a harboring any resentment or whatever in our heart, I think tonight would be a good night to make it right. Watch what you do with my phone. You can play this. You know better than me what you got in your heart and what you ain't got in your heart. So while this song is playing, you can pray at your seat, you can pray at the altar, however you want to do. But if you got any unforgiveness, I think tonight would be a good start. To start off and change that so God can bless you. So you can get the blessings of God if you forgive. That's your most powerful weapon, is forgiveness.
Forgive me. I need your grace to make it through all I
died on the cross for all those things that they did for, that did to him, he could have easily said, oh no, kill these people, but he didn't say that. What did he say? He said, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they do. For all the stuff they did with him hanging on the cross, dying, he said, forgive them, for they don't know what they do. Forgiveness, like I said, it's a powerful thing. Anybody got a testimony tonight?
Amen. I thank the Lord for being here. You brought me a long way.
Amen.
I thank you for everything.
Amen. I thank the Lord for Miss Edna. She's not been on her track a long time, but she's on her track. When I see her, I say, oh yeah, this is it. This is going to be the icing on the cake right here. So you should come home, okay? It may be on YouTube, Jennifer. You just don't want me. She just didn't know it, did she? She didn't know, did she? We had prayer going on about that. She just don't know. Like she said, I'll be keeping Destiny will come, you'll see. It'll all fall in line. She said they won't come together. I told us, well, even if you don't, if you get saved for them, that might be you doing that, then they will come.
Mm-hmm. They will be in your covenant.
She goes ahead and get saved. They'll go around, well, okay, then they see it. Then they'll be like, oh, well. Sometimes that's the way it goes. It falls in line. If there are no more testimonies, we will see everybody back here Tuesday night at 7 o'clock and we stand and be dismissed. Precious Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord God, we thank you for this service. Lord, thank you for the word, God, that it was preached. Help us all to have a loving and a forgiving heart. God, protect us and campaign us around us, Lord, as we go to our homes. Bring us back safely Tuesday night. Register your name and praise your holy name. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Got the car and didn't want to get out.
Oh, he got the car!
He left the neighbor out there. He was screaming and hollering. I come full duty. And right, his car was trying to get him out. I said, Lord, and Lord said, you can't go. I said, my tumor attacked him and had his heart attack.
Oh, did he?
Yeah.
Uh-oh, I got to see my boyfriend.
He looks cute. I mean, he looks cute with the cat. Had time with him. He said, I don't know, the baby's going to sit on the couch. I said, you can't stay in the house because you'd be wanting to try to get out and you start to hurt yourself.
Oh, yeah.
And he back finally got him out on the porch and then he got in the car and he didn't want to get out.
He, I guess he said, I'm going to find out where they be going. And we bring the dogs and the cats in here too. He looks so different when he gets his hair cut like that.
Yeah.
He looks so, he don't even look like the same dog.
Yeah, I'll cut off. I said, I put the camera ticket. We had so much of it that she told me, I said, well, I didn't tell you to tell him to cut it short. She said, well, I did it today. He said, cut it short.
He looks so different. He don't look like the same dog. If I didn't know that was him, I would say it was another dog.
I
got to get my name and put my jingle lingers in here. My jingle bells fell off.
this is the first one with your phone number at the top one. That last time you picked up your number on this one, and I'll tell you.
Oh, okay. Well, you got, you don't turn the other one in?
Uh-uh.
Oh, okay. Well, just bring it now.
6:30. As long as he has your phone number, it's fine, but I'll mind it on the first one ever page.
Okay.
Because he'll take that one.
I guess I better put Pastor Bertha Hall, I put Princess Hall on the other side of Bertha.
We
yeah. don't mean the same thing, you know.
Huh?
What you say?
I see the red in the vent.
A red?
Yep, it's in this vent right here.
Ooh, let it stay there.
Is it there?
Nah, I'm just kidding. It's a battery.
Oh, boy, yeah, he wouldn't have been that calm had it been. Girl, I'd have been screamed. I'd been like, no!
Maybe not, but I'm
sure. Nah, it's one old, you know them, 9-volt batteries?
Yeah.
It's one of those. I don't know why it's in there.
How'd it get down in there?
Who knows?
It wouldn't fit through the crack, so.
But John is untelling. Nothing. I said, well, I tell him it don't matter. I'm the same person. If he has a quiz, they have my numbers. What's up? What we got? What, three? Well, you know what time it is?
8:35.
Been here since 5:30.
Okay, so 3 hours. We'll say 3 hours. Okay. I'll put 3 in there.
I know I need today
and Wednesday. I need 8.5 for 22
days.
Okay.
And a half. And 4 and a half. We can get 4 and a half. This is for him.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we
could.
Can
I take that Bible home? I'll bring it back.
Yeah.
I don't know. No, it ain't. Don't belong to nobody, dude.
Yeah.
Who is?
Rose.
Oh, that's Rose. She can't read it no way. It's too small. Yeah.
We'll let you take it.
It's yours. See.
I'll bring it.
You look cute with your hair up, Jess Lars. You look cute with your hair up.
I had to hang it down, it was flopping around. I said, I just flopped it, this one over there. I had it in the
ponytail,
and I just went around.
You know what Jennifer said? She said,